we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit because he's kind of the he's the third person of the Trinity. You know, we have God the Father, and we have God the Son, and we have God the Holy Spirit. Now, many are confused about the Trinity. How can they all three be different but the same? Well, it's just the fact. They're different but the same. He's all three are God. Now, some religions hate the fact that you would call the Son of God, God, but God calls Him that. God the Son, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit. And it's really just three functions of the same person. Their essence and nature is the same, but their interaction and function is a little different. Just a little, not much. It's kind of like, just like a man can be a husband to his wife. He can be a father to his children. But when he goes to work, he's not husband and father. When he goes to work, his relationship there is different. He carries a different authority there. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Or it can be water, can be ice, it can be water, and it can be just same substance, just different state.
Amen.
So figure that out. Sometimes it's like they got God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Or is it God the Father, the Son, and the Holy... It's like, guys, could y'all just stop moving for just a minute so I can figure you out? But you do have a little bit different relationship with each.
Yes.
And so I want to help you today with that, because our relationship is a little bit different with each of the aspects of God or the persons of God. Okay? With Father, we have one relationship. With the Lord Jesus, we have a little bit different. Even so much that Jesus said in that day, you're going to ask me nothing. You're going to ask the Father for yourself. Remember that?
Yeah.
What's the difference? Well, there's just a little difference. It doesn't mean that somebody can't say, Lord Jesus, help. Doesn't mean that. But technically, he's saying you have a relationship with the Father on your own.
Yes.
But then you got the Holy Spirit. Who's he? What's he going to do with you? Some people don't understand the Holy Spirit so much so that they just rather not talk about the Holy Spirit. And that's nothing new. Back in the Bible day, Paul found some disciples and he said, have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And they said, we haven't even heard if there is a Holy Spirit. He said, then what did you believe unto? Like, that's the ultimate.
Yeah.
To receive the Holy Spirit is the ultimate. That's the ultimate.
Amen.
To have this interaction personally with the Spirit of God is the ultimate. Do you realize this?
Amen.
The cross was not the ultimate.
Amen.
Anybody agree?
Amen.
Anybody disagree?
Yes.
You mean no. The cross was not the ultimate because the Holy Spirit hadn't yet come.
Right.
The promise of the Old Testament was, I'm going to send my Spirit.
Amen.
I promise you, Israelites, I'm going to put my Spirit in you. I promise I'm going to give you my Spirit. I'm going to take your old heart out, put my new Spirit in. I promise.
Yep. Yep.
So the big deal was the Holy Spirit. So you got to know some things here. And this is where the Christian can transition from carnal Christian living to spiritual Christian living.
Amen.
It's where the Christian goes from just kind of a low Christian life to a spark in the eye Christian life.
Yes.
All right.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. By the end of the service, everybody will be enthused. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 here. Are you there? Verse 15. Now let's skip down here to verse 18. But as God is faithful, 2 Corinthians 1:18, but as God is faithful, our word to you was not yes and no. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, by me, Silvanus and Timothy, was not yes and no, but in him was yes. For all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him amen to the glory of God through us. Just wanted you to see the setup here, that all the promises of God that you read in the Bible or that he speaks to your spirit are yes.
Amen.
If you see an I will, then the answer to that is yes. In the Bible, if you see God saying I will, then you can expect a yes, that's for you.
Amen.
Yes.
Or even if he says, if you do, then I will, then he will always do it.
Yes.
Amen. Teach.
Not yes sometimes and no other times, but if you find a promise in the Bible, it's yes.
Yes.
God, will you save me? Yes. God, will you heal me? Yes. God, will you get me a job? Yes. God, will you give me happiness? Will you give me joy? Will you give me peace? Yes, 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 yes. God, am I righteous? Yes.
Yes.
All the promises of God are yes.
Amen.
So you can eliminate the God sometimes says yes and God sometimes said no theology. You okay with that?
Yes. That's what I mean. Yeah.
That's not what the Bible says. It says always yes.
Yes.
Not yes and no, but yes.
Yes.
You okay with that? Now that's for promises that are written for certain. Those promises are always yes. God will never say no. God, will you save me? No. Sorry. He won't do that. Now again, I have to give the disclaimer just in case there's one person that hadn't heard it yet. Now if you're asking God to move, or if you're asking God to marry someone particularly, or if you're asking God to take this job, He might say no. Or if you ask God, do I have to work? I don't want to have to work. I just want to lay home. No. He might say no to those things that aren't written in Scripture.
Yes, that's right.
You with me?
Uh-huh.
But life choice things, he may say no. It may not be the will of God. But the Word of God is the will of God, for sure, for sure.
Teach.
And we got Scripture that says you should work to eat.
Amen.
So no laziness.
That's right.
No mooching. No mooching off mom when you're 25. 35. Well, that's not the message. That's not part of the message. Okay, get back over here. I know moms are okay with that. I'm trying to help you not be okay with it so kids can grow up. Verse 21, now he who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us is God, who also has sealed us and given us the Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee.
Thank you, Lord.
God has given us the Holy Spirit as a guarantee. What is that? Does your Bible say guarantee or does it say earnest? The King James says earnest. New King James says guarantee. Anybody says anything else?
The pledge.
Think of it as, I'm going to buy a house. I promise I will buy this house. How do you know I'm sincere? Because I put down earnest money. I put down pledge money. Right? That hooks me. That hooks me in. I'm guaranteeing I'm going to follow through on this contract. That's what God did with us. He gave us the Holy Spirit to guarantee our salvation. He gave us the Holy Spirit to guarantee He's got us. He's got our future in mind. He's got our eternity set. And the proof is I got the Spirit. Now, of course, the question is, how do I know if I have the Spirit? Am I sure that I have the Spirit? Do I have all the Spirit I need? I want to be sure.
Amen.
So we'll answer that in a moment. But I just wanted you to see the Holy Spirit is our guarantee. All of these little, it's not like the full eternal salvation has taken place for you yet in your consciousness. You understand? We only get a piece of it. We only get the Holy Spirit. We only get the Holy Spirit dwelling in this carnal fallen body, this fallen temple, as our guarantee. And so we don't get the full manifestation of everything. Like, I just want to see you, God. How many of you have prayed that? I just want to see you, God. If you could just show me you. If I could just see Jesus. If I could just have a vision like all these other people. How many of you have ever prayed that? Everybody's scared to raise their hand. I just want to vision. Can I go to heaven? Can I see a vision in heaven? Not for good, but just I want to go up there and have a trip. He doesn't just give you the whole deal. Even if you did get to have a vision of heaven, it'd just be a glimpse, and you'd have to come back to the earth and sort it out in your carnal mind, thinking, did I see what I saw? Thought I saw? What was I? So what we do get is the earnest money. We get the Holy Spirit, and every time you hear a tongue and interpretation, it's a glimpse. Every time there's a prophecy, that was a glimpse. Every time somebody's healed, it's a glimpse. Every time any gift of the Spirit is a glimpse. Every time one sentence from the Holy Spirit is a glimpse. But you don't get much more. You only get a word of knowledge. You don't get to know everything about everybody all the time. You just get one little tiny word.
Amen.
One time I was in a church service and the Lord had me, I could sense He was telling me something, and it was the word pills. Just what He gave me one word, pills. And I said, pills. That's all I could say. I don't know much more. I just said, pills. And then I had to admit, I said, I don't know what that is. Maybe somebody's taking too many pills. Maybe somebody's thinking about it. I don't know what it is. And nobody said anything. So often that happens when you have a word, people don't want to admit it in front, all that. Well, after the service, this lady comes up to me and she says, she said, 5 seconds before you said that, I was thinking in my heart, I couldn't hardly focus because I was thinking about, I need to go take some pills. I need to go take some pills. I need to go take the pills. She said, I've been so consumed with making sure I'm taking pills. And she said, that freed me.
Amen.
So you don't get to know everything. Just get a little bit. We got an earnest. We got a piece of the Holy Spirit. We don't get the feeling all the time. You don't get this constant presence of God. Just floating around, I feel the presence of God, That's why some Christians, they wake up some days and don't even feel saved hardly. Isn't that right? You get up, you're feeling just like old carnal person, I don't even know if this is real or not. That's when you got to take Scripture at His word and say, well, I know the Bible says that I'm got eternal life. These things are written that I may know. The things are written that I may know. The things are written that I may know. Not the things I'm feeling, not the emotions. The emotions aren't there so you know.
No. Right.
Even though when you come together in the Lord, there's a different emotion and there's a different presence and a sense because we're together. There's something different that takes place. Sometimes you feel it in the car, sometimes at home, but a lot of times at church you feel it, but we don't walk by feeling. Somebody's have had the Holy Spirit touch them in a powerful way one time 10 years ago, and they're searching for that again. Where's that feeling again? Remember when in my first church, I used to have all these feelings. Well, you finally grew up. You don't need the feelings.
Amen.
You finally grew up, and now you're walking by faith.
Yes.
And so you don't need to rely on feelings.
Right.
But He gave you those touches as just a little piece of what's to come. Amen. So we have to value the earnest money. You have to value the Holy Spirit. And then we're going to talk about relationship with Him because that's where all the good stuff happens. Look at chapter 5 here. Same thing over here. Chapter 5. Verse 1 says, for we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. What's He talking about? He's talking about your physical body. If your little physical dwelling place right now is destroyed, no problem. We got an eternal place. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. Anybody ever groaned about that? Yes, you have. Every time you say, well, Jesus, why can't you just come now? What are you doing? You're groaning to get out of this troublesome place. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked, for we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed. It's not that you want to die, but we want to be further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up in life.
Yeah.
That's all that passage means. You probably heard this at funerals, right? Now, He who has prepared for us this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. You got an eternal place to dwell. I promise, and here's my proof of promise. You get the Holy Spirit. And then verse 7, for we walk by faith. Well, verse 6, for we're always confident, knowing that while we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight, not by feeling, not by emotion. Listen. The Holy Spirit is the one who's going to help you walk by faith so you don't have to rely on emotions.
Amen.
Well, I'm not feeling very happy today. Well, I'm not feeling like I ought to go to work today. I don't know if I feel like going to church. Honey, you feel like going to church today? You feel like going to church, kids? Oh, you don't? Me too. Look, we don't go to church because we feel like it. We go to church because it's right.
Amen.
We go to church because we have a deposit in our heart of the Holy Spirit and we know what to do. We don't go to work because, oh, it just feels so wonderful. I'm going to go by my feelings. We go to work because it's the right thing to do every day.
Amen.
The left side over here hadn't amened yet this morning. That's okay. You don't have to say amen. Just say yes. You got it. It's exciting though, right? The Holy Spirit is the one that helps you walk by faith. He's the one that, He'll give you a little. He'll give you a little scratch when you're making a dumb choice.
Yes.
That's what He does.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. Hey, y'all wanna? You think well? Think I ought to go to work today? I think I'm gonna stay home today. I don't really feel right about it, but I'm gonna do it anyway. Something's wrong, but I just want to. If you pay attention to the little scratch, you won't make those dumb decisions.
Amen.
That's part of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
What you should be getting is one of these, a little belly rub from the Holy Spirit. That's how He does it, with peace and gentleness and, oh yeah, I'm going to go to work today. Ooh, I feel good about that. I'm going to go to church today. I'm going to feel good. Ooh, I'm going to honor my word today with somebody. Ooh, yeah. Well, I don't want to, but I feel like I should. I told somebody I'd do such and such, but oh, golly, I wish I hadn't have said that now. Oh, but I got to keep my word. Got to keep my word. Isn't that right? Maybe I can get out of it. Maybe I can get out. Maybe I can get out of keeping my word. You with me? Well, I got scripture for that. Just hold on. Turn to John 16. John chapter 16. It's over in John chapter 16, verse 7. Jesus said this. He said, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper," that's capitalized because it was referring to the Spirit, "the Helper will not come to you, but if I depart, I'll send Him to you."
Hallelujah.
Now the King James says comforter, it's paraclete, it's the standby. It's the one that'll jump in the ditch with you if you get in there. Literally, it means the one who will jump in the ditch by your side.
Teach.
And when He has come, He will do some things. He'll convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. He's kind of your restrainer of sin because they don't believe. So the Holy Spirit's going to get involved in saving a soul. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more, the Holy Spirit's the one that's going to assure you that you're right with God. Because you're not going to have Jesus to hold your hand and give you the nod. The Holy Spirit's the one that's going to assure you of your righteousness. Because Jesus is out of here. He said, "I'm out of here," but the Holy Spirit, He will convince the world or the church of righteousness. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged.
Yes.
"I shall have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now." So you can't, back when Jesus was speaking to His disciples, they could not handle the truth. The disciples couldn't handle the truth until they got the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You with me? That's why Spirit-filled people can handle the truth better than non-Spirit-filled people.
Yes, Lord.
Teach.
Verse 13, "However, when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth, for He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears, He'll speak, and He'll tell you things to come. He'll glorify," the Holy Spirit will glorify Me. "He will take of what is Mine and declare it to you." And that's why Spirit-filled people can praise God a little bit easier. That's why Spirit-filled people can go. Non-Spirit-filled people can raise their hands about this much. How do I know? Because I got a Baptist friend pastor who said that. He said, "You know, I don't mind people raising their hands. For me, though, I can't get my hands really past my waist. That's about as far as I can go." The Holy Spirit's the glorifier of Jesus. So when He comes upon you in fullness, woo, you can go all the way. It's the truth. Absolute truth. You know, if you did an analysis, statistics would pretty much prove that out about 95%. Sure, there's some people that can do it without. I'm not saying that that's some rule. I'm just saying the nature of our heart, if it's not full enough with the Holy Spirit, we won't be able to glorify God as much as we'd like to. Spirit-filled people have a little bit more shout. I'm not saying Spirit-filled people don't sometimes look kooky and weird. I'm not saying Spirit-filled people don't sometimes get in the flesh and do things that we really don't feel right. You know, they're doing stuff and it's like, oh, I wish they'd quit. I'm not going to say nothing. I sure love them, but golly, you know. You with me? But when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He'll guide you into all truth, tell you things to come. Verse 14, He'll glorify me, for He'll take what is mine and declare it to you. Turn to chapter 14. That's backwards. Chapter 14 of John. If you love, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and He'll give you another helper, that He may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees Him nor knows Him. But you know Him, for He dwells with you and will be in you. I won't leave you orphans or unadopted. I'll come to you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Now, hold on. I'm not putting down Baptists, and I'm not putting down non-Spirit-filled people. I'm showing you the difference. You need to know that there is a difference of someone who has been clothed with and filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues with power, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
Okay, I'm not making fun of anybody. I were one of those, okay? Most of us, if not all, well, all of us, had to come into the revelation of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And when you get filled with the Spirit, you'll have more revelation of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And you'll be more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. So at the end, we're going to show you how to do that and help people get filled with the Holy Spirit so you can contact the power of God in a way you never have before. And this, every time you speak like this, some people will throw the wall up thinking, oh no, I got the Holy Spirit when I got saved. I got the Holy Spirit when I got saved. Yes. And kind of no. Yes, you did. Yes, you did. When you got saved, you got the Holy Spirit. We'll go prove that out. You ready?
Yes.
Go to Romans chapter 8. Yes, when you got saved, when you received Jesus, you got the Holy Spirit. Yes. Let's go prove that. Romans chapter 8. Verse 16. Says, the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. I would say most of you in here, if not all, would say that you felt that. You know what it feels like to be a child of God.
Yes.
Inside your spirit, there's something that says you're okay.
Yeah.
There's a big yes on that question.
Yes.
Everybody okay with that?
Yes.
Even when you're not feeling real spiritual, deep down you know. Deep down you know.
Yep.
Deep down you know you received Jesus. You know that it's real.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And if you need to be reminded, come to church. Or read your Bible. Or listen to a good preacher. You with me?
Amen.
But deep down, the Holy Spirit is the one that lets you know.
Yes.
How do you... Am I still saved? How do you feel on the inside? Now, that's a lot different than how do you feel in your mind.
Right.
How do you feel on the inside, in your spirit? And this is where you have to get spiritual. You have to learn how to feel and sense the Holy Spirit on the inside. Because I've asked people that before, how do you feel on the inside? And they're like, well, you know, I've been thinking about all these sins and all this stuff, and I just don't know about this scripture and this scripture. Look, I didn't ask you what you're thinking. I asked you how you sense on the inside of your spirit, man. The Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we're sons of God, children of God. What does that mean? The Spirit bears witness with my spirit that I'm a son of God. What does that mean? That means He's on the inside of me. He's not saying anything. He's just going like this.
Yes.
Am I a son of God?
That's right.
He's just giving me a little belly rub.
Amen.
You with me?
Yeah.
The Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit.
Amen.
What does that mean? He's letting us know.
Yes.
He's witnessing to the fact that we're children of God.
Amen.
If you've received Jesus, you should have that witness.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Therefore, someone who has received Jesus has the Holy Spirit. Or we could say has a witness of the Holy Spirit in their heart. You with me? So I'm not negating that the Holy Spirit is in the hearts of every single believer in Christ, whether they speak in tongues or not. Some people who are wrong, who've gone overboard the other direction, say that if you haven't spoken in tongues, then you're not even saved. Well, that's wrong. That can't be right. That can't be right. Logic tells you that's not right. But if somebody gets hung up on one scripture without reading the rest of the scriptures... So we're going to come back to Romans 8, but I think I better go to Acts 19 and just show you some proof here. You know, listen, the Word of God is our proof, okay? The Holy Scriptures are our proof. It's our only proof and nothing but the proof.
Amen.
Really, if we can't prove it in the Bible, then we can't preach it.
Amen.
And we can say it, but we can't preach it as doctrine. We can say it and say it's our opinion, but if it's not in Scripture proven out by two or three witnesses, particularly in the New Testament, we won't preach that.
Amen.
So you always have a right to say prove it.
Amen.
Anything you hear in church or from any preacher anywhere, you have a right to say prove that by Scripture. Can you prove that by Scripture? I'd like to see that in the Scripture.
Amen.
Isn't that right? It keeps you safe, doesn't it? Helps you feel good, doesn't it? We need that. I'm not happy if I can't do that. If I can't prove it in Scripture, it may sound good, may tickle my ear, may give me some encouragement, but I'm going to shelve it until I can prove it.
Amen.
That's right.
Acts chapter 19, verse 1, and it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding some disciples, he said to them. What do you mean he found some disciples? Yeah, he found some believers in God. Found some disciples, you know, doing their best. A lot of people believe in God, love God with all their heart. They just don't know much. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said to them, "Into what then were you baptized?" So they said, "Into John's baptism." What's that? That's John the Baptist who went about paving the way for Jesus, baptizing people unto repentance. Remember that?
Yeah.
That they were ready for a change. They were open to what God had for them. Even though the cross hadn't happened yet, so they couldn't be saved. They couldn't be born again yet, but they were ready. So they had been baptized by John already, or into his baptism, into following John the Baptist. Verse 4, then Paul said, "John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people they should believe on him who would come after him," John the Baptist, "that is on Jesus Christ. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus." So they'd already been baptized in water once with John. Now they got baptized in water second time in the name of Jesus after they believed on Him. That's it. That's all they needed to do. Close the book. Praise the Lord. They got dunked in the name of Jesus. Okay, look up here. At this point, they have heard the message of Jesus, willingly and gladly been baptized in water. Glory to God. That's what we acknowledge as certain salvation, right?
Yes.
Certain salvation. I mean, only God knows the heart, but we say that they outwardly expressed a faith in Jesus and then outwardly, willingly went under the water and came back up. They are saved, right? They are born again, correct? And that's how many Christians live their entire rest of their life at that level. They got saved and believed in Jesus and baptized in water, glory to God. We will see them in heaven. And they will do their best to serve God. And they will learn the Bible just like everybody.
Amen.
Sometimes better than some.
Come on. Yes.
Right? But our question is that it?
No.
Well, if you close the book, then it's it. But if you keep reading the rest of the passage, it's not it. And you and I got to be open to the rest of the passage.
Amen.
Verse 5, when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. Stop there. Hands what? Laid where? Now, some denominations don't preach the laying on of hands. They don't teach that doctrine at all. They have erased the laying on of hands doctrine completely for various reasons. But we see it in the Bible, so we have to do it.
Amen.
Even if we don't like it, we got to do it.
Amen.
Well, I don't know why God can't just do anything He wants to do to me without somebody having to lay hands on me and get the glory for it. People are so worried about everybody else getting the glory. God's not worried about that. Matter of fact, God and Jesus decided laying on of hands was necessary. God and Jesus want to see us relating to one another, trusting one another, having some fellowship with one another, needing one another, providing for one another, caring for one another, laying hands on one another to help God do things for people.
Yes.
It's almost like God could do everything by Himself, but He wants us to be real brothers.
Amen.
So He's going to make you come get hands laid on you sometimes. For me, I read this type of thing and studied it out, and man, I was ready. I wanted the Holy Spirit. Now, I was saved as a kid, got baptized in water as an adult. I'm ready for everything.
Yeah.
I didn't have any doubt in me whatsoever about the Holy Spirit and this next thing. And so I tried to do it by myself. For 3 months, I tried to do it in my, you know, in my hotel rooms, or my corporate apartment, wherever I was. I tried to do it by myself. I mean, I was determined. I'd go home after work every day. I'm ready, God. For 3 months. Nothing. It worked. Tonight I'm going to do it in my hotel. Tonight I'm going to sit on that bed until I get filled with the Holy Spirit and speak with tongues. And after about 5 minutes of waiting, nothing would happen. Finally, I got fed up. I said, I need help. I went to a church. After the church service, a fella took me to the side and he said, what do you need? Actually, he was taking me to the Salvation Room. I'm like, oh, no, that's going to waste my time. I don't want to go sit through the Salvation thing. I've already been there. I'm like, oh, I'm already saved. I just need to get filled with the Spirit. He goes, oh, okay. And he detoured me. I was like, thank God he detoured me. I don't have time for all that. Sat me down in the front row, laid hands on me, and I spoke with tongues.
Right.
Well, I fell on the floor, too, but I spoke with tongues. It was glorious. And I only had a few words, but I knew I got it.
Amen.
Right, so I needed hands laid on me. Not everybody. Some people just sit there. I'm always so jealous of them. In a godly jealousy. People that say, oh yes, I was just sitting there after I got saved and just praising God and it just started coming out. I got the power fell all over me. I'm like, oh man. It took me 3 months. Verse 5 again. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. That's in water. Verse 6, and when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. How do they know the Holy Spirit came upon them? Well, keep reading. And they spoke with tongues and prophesied. There you go. There's your proof. If you ever have any questions for yourself or anybody else, there's the sequence of events. And you see it another time, a sequence of events. When Peter was preaching, they spoke in tongues first. While he was preaching, they just got so thrilled, they started speaking in tongues. That means they were saved and filled with the Spirit and spoke in tongues before they were water baptized. So there's no order of things necessarily, right? You don't have to go through some legalistic order of things. You just got to be real open to Jesus, get saved, and real open to the Holy Spirit and get filled, and then be submissive and get baptized in water. Verse 7, now the men were about 12 in all. I don't know why he put that in, but I think it's interesting. I think that proves it's okay to count.
Amen.
How many got saved? How many got filled with the Spirit? We can count them. Why? I don't know. It's fun. I see some of you aren't convinced. Go back to Romans with me, please. So today, at the end, if you want to be filled with the Spirit and speak with tongues, now if you get laid hands on you for the Holy Spirit to come upon you, you can expect to speak in tongues and or prophesy. Mainly, in that moment, tongues would be more of a praise to God and a prayer language that you get. I remember one story, a missionary friend in Mexico, he was down there preaching and prayed for people to be filled with the Spirit, and the people fell out, just people everywhere, getting filled with the Spirit, speaking in tongues. And he walked by one, and the guy was saying, glory to God, hallelujah, praise the Lord, glory to God, hallelujah, praise the Lord. And he said, sir, no, not English, not English, not English. And the guy just kept going, glory to God, praise God, hallelujah. And the interpreter said, no, he doesn't speak English. He only speaks Spanish. He was praising God in English, in his tongues, right? So that's one thing that happens the initial moment. It's a lot of praise going on. That's why I always tell people, just worship God and love Jesus and praise Him with all your heart and let it come out in a new language.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
I said go back to Romans, right?
Yeah.
Romans chapter 8. Now, let me show you why it's important, okay? I think the one point I wanted to make was you can expect to speak in tongues and or prophesy. And then subsequently, you can expect to have some gifts of the Spirit start happening with you. And then you can also expect to be more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You can expect to be more sensitive to the to the leading of the Spirit. You can expect to hear a sentence or two from God. You can expect supernatural things to begin to manifest and take place that you're in tune with rather than just kind of clueless to.
Amen.
Yes.
It'll take you from just being led by billboards and bumper stickers. What a coincidence. Wow, I was just thinking about that. It'll take you from there into, ooh, ooh, I already knew that was going to happen. I already sensed that that was going to happen. Ooh, I just knew today such and such was going to happen. Ooh, I just sensed that so-and-so was going to call. Ooh, I just knew it. I just knew it.
Hallelujah.
It goes from, wow, I was waiting for all these leaves to fall and make the pattern, God loves you, in the ground. And it was a sign and a wonder. I woke up knowing God loves me. Whew, glory to God. I got this feeling on the inside.
Yes.
See, it'll take you from one to the other. Take you from carnal Christian living to spiritual Christian living.
Hallelujah.
All right. Now let's read and see some of the real deep benefits here. I mean, this is real spiritual stuff that Jesus paid a dear price for us to have.
That's right.
Come on.
You and I, we got to know the Holy Spirit. We got to get real close to the Holy Spirit. That's where the good life is.
Yes.
Romans 8 verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So if you're in Christ, then there's no judgment towards you.
Amen.
Now you don't have to run around saying, don't judge me. If you're having to say, don't judge me a lot, you need to judge yourself. No condemnation of those who are in Christ who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit.
Yes, amen.
Notice this, walking according to the Spirit.
Amen.
Now I'm subject to someone else.
Yes, amen.
Now I'm subject to the Spirit. Now I don't just run through life
amen.
Without
amen.
Any guidance. Now I'm submitted. I can't just decide everything about my life on my own. Now I have to submit to the Holy Spirit. And if you don't, you'll start feeling condemned. It's like at the beach. You ever been to the beach? Some of you are scared of sharks still. That's okay. At the beach, have you ever taken off from the sand and run out to the beach? Just run through the waves. You take off from the sand and you start running and you start hitting the ankle deep and you're splashing and splashing. You're getting a little deeper and then all of a sudden you're high stepping and all of a sudden you can't move anymore and you just dive into the waves. None of you?
Yes.
Just a few of you?
Yes.
Now you know what my vacations are like. Okay. Or you can play football in the little shallows, but once you get out in the knee deep, you can't really move much. The Holy Spirit would be the water. And when you're newly saved, man, you're just splashing around in the ankle-deep water. And glory to God, this is so much fun. But as you get a little deeper with God, then you're kind of more subject to the water. You get knee-deep and it's like, well, I can't really go quite like I want to go. And you go out a little further and it's like, ooh, now I'm really at the mercy of the water.
Yes.
That's how it should be with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Remember Ezekiel's vision that when he measured the temple? And it was first ankle-deep water, and then it was knee-deep water, and then waist-deep, then he was swimming.
Mm-hmm.
We're supposed to get to the swimming place where we're really subject to the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Okay, so this is the key, this is the goal for us, that we're relinquishing our will to the Holy Spirit all of our life.
Yeah.
More and more and more and more and more, so that we can allow Him to be our guide.
That's right.
Right? Rather than just bull rushing through this world on our own. So walk according to the Spirit. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
Skip down to verse 5. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. If you're just a carnal head, if you're just a natural thinker, if you're an emotionally moved person, it's gonna lead to death, meaning you won't have joy in life. You won't have peace. You'll just be like a sinner down the street, basically, if you're carnally minded. Christian happens to Christians all the time. So much that some of them claim that. Well, I know I'm just too carnal. Well, quit it then.
Amen.
Verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God. It's hostile, unfriendly against God. For it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. This is why it's not about you convincing your mind.
Right.
It's about you letting your spirit man connect to the spirit.
Right.
So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. How many of you want to please God? Everybody raise your hand.
Amen.
How many of you want to please God in this life? Listen, this life is about pleasing God.
Amen.
This whole life is about you and I pleasing God. Not as some taskmaster, but because He is so loving and good.
Yes. Amen.
Children, in a family, your job as a kid is to please mom and dad.
Amen.
Yeah. To please the one you're subject to. You'll see when you get to heaven, it'll be so glorious if you pleased God. Verse 9, but you're not in the flesh, but in the spirit. So this is like we're speaking a faith statement over everybody. You're not in the flesh, so quit thinking like that.
Amen.
You're not in the flesh, you're in the spirit.
Amen.
Listen, all of you at Houston Faith Church, you're in the spirit.
Amen.
Come on, you're in the spirit.
Amen.
We're doing all we can to keep you in the spirit. We're like all tied together in the water, and we're going out.
Amen.
Yes.
If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he's not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness.
Amen.
Once the Spirit shows up in you, all of a sudden, flesh man has to die.
Amen.
All of a sudden, it's like, oh man, I got to let these things go.
Amen. That's right.
Yes.
Skip to verse 12. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live. You're not a debtor to your flesh.
Amen.
That means you can get up when the alarm clock goes off.
Amen.
Amen.
Really, this, you need to practice this with your alarm clock. Just get up, quit hitting the snooze button. But I'm so sleepy. Your flesh, just you whip that into shape. When I was a heathen, I had to have a snooze alarm. I had to have a backup alarm not near the bed. And then I had to hope real hard that I made it. Now, part of that was just because I was going to bed at 4, getting up at 7. That's ridiculous. Come on, whatever your flesh is getting the dominance over you, you have to win. You have to recognize, oh, no, I'm not a debtor to my flesh. I don't owe you anything.
Amen.
How many times has your flesh said, oh, well, I deserve this? I deserve a day off. I deserve... Don't think like that. You're not a debtor to the flesh.
Amen.
Amen.
Verse 13, for if you live according to the flesh, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. That's what that says. If you put to death the deeds of the body, you'll live. What's that mean? That means, it didn't just say that. It said if by the Spirit. By the Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the body. This is not willpower. This is not, I'm not going to smoke, 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 I'm not going to smoke. Right? That's somebody without the Spirit has to do that. With the Spirit, you simply say, hello, Holy Spirit. What would you like us to do today? I just want to talk to you today, Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. I'm just so delighted in you. I'm so comforted by you, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm just so in love with Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Show me what to do today. Oh, I just want to see some wonderful things happen in the Lord. And then if you'll do that for 30 minutes, you'll forget about smoking.
Amen.
For 30 minutes. Yeah, you don't just replace your smoking time with nothing. You replace it with the Spirit.
Yeah.
If you, through the Spirit, mortify the deeds of the body, you'll live.
Amen.
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 Glory is good.
Yeah. I mean, look at it. Look, how many of you sin on Sunday morning between 10:30 and 12:30? Between 10:30 and 12:30 Sunday morning, you're in here. And you're not sinning. And if you are, I don't know about it. I don't want to know about it. For the most part, between 10:30 and 12:30 Sunday morning, you're not sinning. Right? During church service, you're not sinning. You're pleasing God. You're doing something that has eternal treasure attached. You're growing. You're learning. You're applying something that can help your life. And everybody's around you, right?
Amen.
Now, at 12:31, I don't know what you're doing. Seems to me like the secret is church. Why don't you just go to church every day?
Amen.
Why don't you stay in church longer? Go to church every day. That could handle it, right?
Amen.
If you were in church 7 nights a week, how many nights would you be tempted to go? I'm talking about church from, 8 to 2. Okay, I guess I've lost everybody. God, help me get them back. I was just trying to use that as an example. I didn't mean to lose you. I didn't mean to get everybody mad at me for promoting too much church. But if you through the flesh, if you according to the flesh live, you'll die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you'll live. All right. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. So what this is saying is, listen. It's not about me giving you a list of rules. This is about you meeting the Holy Spirit. You and I have to meet the Holy Spirit enough to sense Him, to like Him, to not grieve Him, to not quench Him.
Amen.
When He says, oh no, don't make that phone, I'm going to get on the phone and I'm going to give them the what for. And the Holy Spirit says, oh, no, don't do that.
Right.
And you're like, okay, sorry. That's through the Spirit mortifying the deeds of the body. When you're about to text something, look, if your mouth gets like that when you're about to text something, you don't even need the Holy Spirit. Just don't do it. But as you're about to... The Holy Spirit's like, no, don't you do that. You're about to post something or comment to something online. Don't do that. Just hold. No. That's through the Spirit, mortifying the deeds of the body.
Amen.
Somebody offends you. Somebody is rude to you. Somebody doesn't consider you or think about you. And the first thought is, I got to tell somebody about this. Some of you. Not in this church. Other people, when somebody hurts their feelings, they're like, I got to tell somebody about this. You got to know, they hurt my feelings. The Holy Spirit's like, oh, no, don't do that. Forgive them. Oh, no, please don't spread that. Don't spread that. This is Holy Spirit living. At work, whenever you're just pretty much fed up, the Holy Spirit's like, oh, don't get fed up. Be patient with these people. And then if you'll just do that, if you'll just be real nice and sweet, even though they're slapping you around at work, oh, you'll get such a good feeling on the inside. Ooh. It'll help you smile at them. Glory to God. I love you. Is there anything I can do for you extra? I'll take some of your workload. Would you like me to take some of your workload? Here, just go home early today if you can. I'll just take care of your work for you. Come on, get the grace of God. Walk in love. Be a real Christian. Be just so fanatically Christian and loving that, man, they just can't resist Jesus anymore. Only the Spirit can help you do that.
That's right.
We're not talking about willpower. Willpower, well, you'll just grit your teeth. Okay, I know I'm supposed to love them. That's the person without the Spirit. Listen, even in your marriages, you don't get to do that. Oh, I love them, God. No. You missed the Holy Spirit. Listen, you missed the Holy Spirit if you have to act like that. The Holy Spirit will actually change you on the inside so that you can think in your heart, oh, I love them, God.
All right.
It's all about this little thing on the inside. It's an attitude that comes out because the Holy Spirit has hooked up with you, or you with Him. Praise the Lord. Of course, 1 Corinthians 2 says, "Eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love Him, but He has revealed them to us through His Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God."
Right.
Remember that? So the Spirit does all this stuff for you. The Spirit shows you things to come. He's the revealer of God's will to your life. You must know Him. You must know the Holy Spirit. You must pray in tongues to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You must get familiar with that smoothness or that scratch, or your life will be in jeopardy.
That's right.
You know, you can destroy your life by ignoring the Holy Spirit. Just one sentence to your spouse can pretty much set you on a course you don't want to be on. And it'll take you years to get back. You must hold your tongue in your marriage.
Amen.
I said, you must hold your tongue in your marriage. But the Holy Spirit is the one who's going to guide you through this life. And if you're not being guided by the Holy Spirit, it's going to be a difficult road, and you're going to encounter problems that you didn't expect. And then your question is going to be, well, God, how come you let this happen? Isn't that right? Remember my story about my lip?
Good story.
Anybody not heard my lip story?
Tell it again.
I was in my late 20s and I started playing basketball, pickup games, you know, and getting in shape, and it was kind of fun. I had some pastor friends I was playing with, and that was all fun. And, you know, I'm a decent athlete, you know, nothing exceptional, but I'm a decent athlete. And, but, you know, my shot was off. You know, if you hadn't played something in a long time, you know, good at it, right? Even though you kind of look, you got the form, you're not consistent enough. So I decided I'm going to go out and practice a little bit in my neighborhood. So I went over to this basketball court in my neighborhood at this little center. And I was shooting around outside and practicing my shot and all. And I looked inside the gym and there's a game going on. I'm like, I'm going to go in there. Went in there and watched these guys play. I'm like, I'm going to join one of these games. So I joined the next team that was waiting, you know, and jumped in there and played a game. And we won. My little five guys, we won. Now, they were all younger than me. They were probably, you know, around 20, 18, 20, bigger than me, almost all of them. But I was playing pretty good. I mean, I was shooting good, having fun, and it was fun. And then we played a second game. You know, if you win, you keep the court. And we played a second game and won. Ha! It's fun. Played a third game. Won that one too, and I was doing good. I was like number 2-3 on the team. And then all of a sudden, I had this little scratch on the inside of me. Now, this was a Saturday, and Sunday morning, I had to go preach down in LaPorte and Lamarck. And so this was Saturday evening, or Saturday late afternoon, and I had this little scratch in me that it was time to go. I just sensed that the grace to play was over. And, but I'm playing good. And we're winning. I mean, you got to stay on the court. You got all these reasons. I mean, you know, the world says there's just a lot of reasons for me to continue on this course that I've decided and planned. Let that soak in. But I just felt like I needed to leave. And you know, logistically, I wanted to get home and prepare for the next day and such, so that was kind of on my mind anyway, but I just didn't feel right. But I said, I just thought in my mind, just one more game, Snowpoint, just one more game. This will be my last game. Okay, this will be my last game. The very first play of that fourth game, the biggest guy on the court ran at me on purpose and hit me in the mouth with his elbow. Now, he's a big dude, and his momentum was so... It was so strong that it didn't bust my lip. Anybody ever busted a lip? It didn't bust my lip. It demolished my lip. The tissue, I felt the tissue disappear so much that I kind of hit the deck. And as I was getting up, I could tell that my lip was as big as my nose. Instantly... And I got up, and the guys' faces, they're like... It was hardly even bleeding. Wow. It was just demolished tissue.
Wow.
I got to go home, guys. And I'm thinking, I got two thoughts. One is, oh no, how am I going to preach in front of people with a second nose on my face? And my second thought was, God tried to show me. He tried to help me. The Holy Spirit tried to help me and I ignored Him. And I blew a whole week. And that, I don't know if you can still see it, but it's still a little tiny noticeable indentation. I mean, a little long, anyway. It's a decent reminder not to neglect the scratch, right?
Amen.
One time I was sitting at a traffic light, and it turned green. I was first one. It turned green, and in my heart, I just detected just a pullback, and I didn't go. I'm thinking, why am I not going? Whoom! And a car comes speeding by me. Now, I kind of think that might have been an angel, but Holy Spirit and the sensitivity rather than... And this is one little side note. In following the Holy Spirit, you have to be careful when you're with somebody. Because when you're with somebody, there's a little pressure.
Yeah.
Like, what if the person next to me said, go, it's green. Then you have to ignore two things. Yeah. What you normally do and what someone's reminding you to do. So spouses and friends, be careful about forcing someone when they seem to have a reason to alter course.
That's good. That's very good.
Rick Renner tells a story about he was in a convention in Chicago. And in the convention, he was one of the speakers. Week-long deal. A lot of preachers. And so he had preached already. And the last night of the meeting came. And he didn't feel like he should go to the meeting. And he and his wife were in the hotel room, and he was getting ready, and his wife's like, well, what's the matter? And he said, well, I don't know, I don't feel like I should go tonight. And she's like, well, if you don't want to go, that's fine with me. If you don't want to go, it's fine with me. He's like, yeah, but I should go, you know. It's rude to already have preached and then not go up to support the next minister. You know, some people do that. As soon as they're done, they leave. So he's going through these natural emotions of a preacher. No, I've got friends there, and you know, it's the last night, I want to see everybody. So he got ready, and he's deciding he's going to go. And he expressed right before they walked out the door, he's like, I just don't feel right about going. She's like, hey, honey, if you don't want to go, just stay. I'll just go by myself. He's like, oh, I don't want you to go by yourself. I'll just go. So the driver was waiting for him down, and they got in the car. And as he's getting in the car, he tells the driver as he's kind of walking past, he says, I just don't know. I don't know if I'm supposed to go to this or not. I don't feel right about going. And the driver says, oh, you don't have to go if you don't want to. I'll just take your wife or y'all both, whatever you want to do. It's up to you. He's like, no, it's fine. I'll just go. He gets in the car and they're driving there and he can't get it off his mind. He's like, something just doesn't feel right about going to this tonight. I just don't, blah, 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 blah. And the driver's like, I'll turn around if you need to. He's like, no, just keep going. It's no problem. They show up at the convention. He and his wife walk in, and they're greeting people in the lobby. And he still has this feeling he can't shake. And he's like, honey, I just can't shake this. I've got to go back to the hotel. She's like, no problem. Just going back to the hotel, and everything's okay. He's like, okay. So he got the driver. They got back in the car, and he's headed back to the hotel. And he tells his driver, he says, before we go back to the hotel, just stop by the convenience store. I need to get a few things. So he took his time getting back to the hotel. When he gets back to his hotel, opens the door, and instantly realizes why the Holy Spirit didn't want him to go to the meeting. His hotel room had been robbed. All the jewelry was on the bed, sorted in different piles, and only the best pile was taken. They had time to sort the jewelry. His laptop was taken that had 5 books that he was writing. All of his passports and credit cards that were left in the hotel were gone. Now, his person was spared and his wife was spared. But he was just a little bit too late. At least he knew. Those are the lessons we learn. Right? He had a feeling. That's how the Spirit does it. The Spirit doesn't show up with a red blinking light and a megahorn. Don't go. Your place is about to be robbed. No, he doesn't do that, and that's why typically all those thoughts you have about all the fears, well, don't do that because then somebody will break in. Don't do this because of that. Those are from the devil. God doesn't do it that way. He wants you to follow the Holy Spirit. Now, sometimes the Holy Spirit will speak to you in a sentence form and it comes from here, not from here. Those worries come from here. The Holy Spirit comes from here. But see, this is you getting familiar with the Holy Spirit. He's your guide. Jesus is in heaven. God's in heaven. The Holy Spirit's all you got.
Right.
Now, He's the same as them, but He's the one you have to get familiar with. You don't get to touch Jesus' flesh. You got to get sensitive on the inside.
Right.
You got to establish a relationship with the Holy Spirit. He's
Amen.
Only one.
Amen.
And so Rick Renner tells the rest of the story. Well, let me just present this to you. What if he had obeyed the Holy Spirit? His wife goes, or maybe she stays, and he's left in the hotel room. What do you think most likely happened? Most likely, someone showed up to the door and knocked. Just to make sure. Now, if he would have opened the door and said, "Can I help you?" the thief would have gone on and never come in. And then he would have had to go through the rest of the night and the next week and the rest of his life having no idea why the Holy Spirit didn't want him to go to that meeting. And all of his preacher friends, "How come you didn't show up at the last meeting? What's wrong with you?" "Well, I just didn't feel to." Oh, come on. Then you got to put up with all the people who have no idea what you felt.
Right. That's right.
But spiritual people, that's how we live our lives. Jesus was misunderstood many times because he was spiritual. Whether it was eating or drinking or traveling, Jesus made different decisions that the disciples didn't understand. People didn't understand. How come you won't let your mother in your... So a lot of times when you follow the Holy Spirit, you don't know what you avoided.
Yeah, right.
So you got to get familiar with that gentle, smooth belly rub, tug, whatever it is. Notice the scratch. Just make your decision when you feel the scratch. Yeah. Isn't that exciting? So Rick Renner's final story is this. The next year, he and his family had planned a vacation. So they lived in Russia. You know, he's got a church there. And the next Christmas, they were going to spend Christmas because from Russia, you can get a lot of places in Europe very cheaply. And so he planned his trip to Sri Lanka, and Christmas Eve was going to be their arrival or whatever. But they were going to be there during Christmas. So he schedules his trip, and they're all excited. All the family's excited. And here comes the day before the trip, and he gets that feeling again. And he's thinking, oh. But he remembers Chicago. He goes to his family and says, "I got bad news. We can't go." They're like, "Why? Why?" He goes, "I don't know. I just know we can't go." "Whoa, Dad! Oh! Sorry, can't go." So they canceled the trip. And that was, I think, 2004, when the first huge tsunami of this century demolished Sri Lanka. And all of that area. Remember that?
Yep.
Particularly the very hotel that they were going to be staying in. That was the one that made the news. But he was protected because he followed the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
There's a benefit to getting a relationship with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But we have to learn lessons sometimes. I don't have any grand stories. The lip story is about as grand as I can get because it caused me physical harm. Thank God that was what? Golly, that was 16 years ago. Maybe I've been following the Spirit a little better. I don't know. Of course, God can protect you by His own mercy too. Just by His own mercy He can protect you, but you can't just rely on that.
Amen.
He does expect us to. Now, some people will think, yeah, you disobeyed God, so He zapped your lip. No, that's not what happened. He tried to help me avoid something He knew was coming. You got to get this straight. God's not punishing people. He's trying to help us avoid things. But why didn't He just force us? Because He doesn't do it that way. God loves this spirit relationship that we have with Him, and you got to delight in it and put effort into that.
Thank you for joining us for the preaching of God's Word. We trust that your faith and your love for God is stronger than ever before. More information about Stevenson Ministries and Houston Faith Church is available online at HoustonFaith.tv. Chaz and Joni Stevenson are the pastors of a dynamic, growing church in Houston, Texas, and have a New Testament vision of preaching the uncompromised Word of God with the power of the Holy Spirit, helping people get saved and building strong Christians who can impact their world. Houston Faith Church is a place where the love of God is real, where lives are changed, and where followers of Jesus become fishers of men.